All right, here we are. May the 4th be with you. Coffee with the founder. I got my coffee cup, my coffee. And of course, we have another great guest, a friend, a colleague, a true sister, Karen Gaffney. Karen, we're doing these coffee talks as a way to introduce people to all the great people in the world of WPC. So let's start and just ask you, who are you? What do you do?
Great. Well, first of all, thank you so much for the invitation to have this conversation. I really appreciate it. And I was so sorry that the gathering, the important gathering of the White Privilege Conference couldn't happen this year. But I am looking forward to being there next year. So regarding who I am, I am an educator who works hard to use an anti-racist approach in my work and in my activism. And just to expand on that a little bit, I'm an English professor at Raritan Valley Community College in New Jersey, and I've been there for 17 years. I'm also the author of Dismantling the Racism Machine, a Manual and Toolbox, and that is an accessible introduction to race and racism in the US with some tools for action. And I also work in Central New Jersey, facilitating, volunteering to facilitate and work with two different groups that meet monthly. Well, now we meet virtually, but we used to meet in person. Two anti-racism groups in New Jersey, and we're especially focused on working with white people to dismantle white supremacy.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, thank you for that, Karen. I'm going to ask you a couple questions in the future, which are based on your last point about organizing white folks, whether it's affinity, caucus, people, you know, name that different things. But I just want to know, over your years of doing that, what have you learned? What's changed? What are the challenges? But I also wanted to ask you about 17 years of teaching. Right? Like, what has evolved in reference to working with folks around, especially the topics you work with? But first, I mean, I can't get over this phenomenal title, Dismantling the Racism Machine. I'm sure you get this all the time. What the heck does that mean? Can you break that down for the listening audience?
Sure. So thank you for that question. So, one of the reasons that I worked on creating a title like that was to try to make a complex concept a little bit more accessible. So I wanted to write something that could be read by people new to thinking about race, especially white people who really have not been educated about race. Even if they have a graduate degree, they've often not been educated about race. And so I wanted to create a concept, the racism machine, to show that race is a construct. Race is something made by humans. Race is not natural. Race is not biological. That human beings created race for several reasons, and we can certainly get into that. But I thought that the language of something mechanical, like a machine, would help reinforce that it is an invention with a purpose about power and control and white supremacy. And then the idea of a machine also helped me be able to talk about the ways in which a machine can be modified and adapted and changed over time, recalibrated for new circumstances. And we certainly know that white supremacy has the incredible power to keep adapting to new circumstances because it has been doing that for centuries.
Yeah, and I think it's, I don't know if that's inviting, if it's hopeful, but you say dismantling. So can you just talk yes. about what that means? Because sometimes when you talk about white supremacy, recalibrating, refocusing, and then dismantling, like how do those two go together? Is there hope?
Well, I do have to believe there's some hope, but I think that one of the ways that we can work toward dismantling is first recognizing what this machine is. And I think especially when it comes to white people, many of them don't even know this machine exists. They don't know that racism is systemic and structural and institutional. They don't recognize that they benefit from unearned advantages that have been implemented historically for a purpose of benefiting white people. They just think, well, I worked hard and therefore my hard work led to my success. And so I think that recognizing first that this racism machine exists is one step towards dismantling it. But then once white people especially learn about this machine, and I think do so in a way where they're not being blamed for their ignorance, because the whole reason the racism machine continues is based on white people not learning about this. So it's not a coincidence. This is not really part of our K-12, traditional educational system. But I think there are at least a good number of white people who, once they start to learn about this, are interested in taking the next step. Now, some, of course, are in denial and absolutely refuse to engage. And I would say for me, that's probably not so much the people that I would focus on first. I'd rather focus on people who are willing to at least try to grow. But I think ultimately, if we can build a critical mass of people who are willing to learn and recognize the racism machine, then working towards recognizing the policies, the behaviors, the beliefs that contribute to that is a step toward eventually dismantling it.
Yeah, yeah. I sometimes wonder, in all the work I've done and all the places I've been, if people are more frustrated or challenged by the people they live with and they love the most around getting this work. I mean, and many times people talk about how those folks are clueless. Like, I mean, they're almost like the first year high school student or even college student that's just never grappled with this kind of language, these terms. Or if it's the progressive, all inclusive, all loving person, particularly white person. But let me ask you, what's been your experience? I don't know if I want to ask you to have to necessarily pick which one is tougher, but just can you talk a little bit about how you work with those two different groups, whether it's someone who just doesn't know, willing to know, that maybe you love, you live with, or is it someone that thinks they know and needs to know? That kind of progressive person that seems to get it all the time, but really doesn't get it.
Sure. I certainly work with both groups regularly. So just as an example, because I teach at a community college, all of our students are by definition first year or second year college students. So we're not teaching any advanced upper level courses for juniors and seniors, not to mention graduate classes. So my entire approach in a course that I developed on race was that we are starting from the very beginning, and that we're not taking anything for granted, and that we are working together to learn that race is a social construct, an invention, why that is, and then to apply it in looking at various moments in history. And it is technically an English course, though it's interdisciplinary. So I think ultimately we're looking at literature too. But I think for me, for people that are really new to this, then using an approach that is just very open is really critical. And frankly, in that kind of situation, we have a full semester. And so do we talk about white privilege on day one? No, we don't. We get there, but you know, it's the course is set up in such a way so that we take one step at a time. And so that approach for me, I've been teaching that class for more than 10 years. I adapted it for the community in an open version that was just free and open to the public. That worked relatively well. But I think the other group that you're talking about, the well-meaning white people group, in some ways they are more challenging because they certainly come into any sort of discussion or conversation thinking that they already know a lot about the topic. And some of them think they already know everything and shouldn't have to even participate in a further conversation about racism. And so I think, I go back to Dr. King's letter from Birmingham jail, where he talks about the white moderate as one of the most dangerous people in perpetuating white supremacy. And, I see that certainly over the years in the work that I do in the community. I mean, just one example right now in the context of the coronavirus is there is a clear distinction between people who are going out and protesting against stay-at-home orders. And the well-meaning white people are very critical of those white people, but the well-meaning white people, at the same time as they're criticizing those protesters, are essentially saying, well, we just need to wait until everything goes back to normal. And the perception that normal is good, that if we just go back to the way things were in January or December, then everything will be okay. But normal means the status quo, and the status quo means white supremacy. And so I just hear a lot from the so-called, well-meaning white people that they are never able to really fully grasp that the norm that they supposedly embrace is a norm of white supremacy and structural racism. And so that's a challenge.
Yeah, that's powerful. I appreciate that. It's been interesting watching people, myself included, give some critical analysis and sometimes even demeaning characteristics to those folks out in those places gathering in such large numbers because of, who knows for what reasons, whether it's the folks garnishing weapons or folks who are just feeling like they need to get their kids out of the house. They're just, right? And even myself finding, well, I'm not quite 6 feet away, is it worse to be the person that says, I want my job back, blah, 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 and this is made up, hyped up, or the people who are just easing in to 4 feet, 3 feet, drinking our lattes and sitting out on our driveways. It's just going to be interesting, I think, over these next 3 months. But it makes me ask you about just organizing people in general, but especially white folks, because I think there's going to be some work we have to do collectively, but also in affinity space. But can you talk about, because I know you've done some work around white affinity space, you mentioned organizing white folks. What's been some of the perks and some of the challenges of doing that?
Sure. So I think one of the things that might be helpful to understand if people are not that familiar with New Jersey is New Jersey is one of the most racially segregated states in the entire country. But we don't exactly advertise that, right? Mm-hmm. And so when we talk about ourselves, we tend to say, oh, we're very diverse. And that we have many immigrants and people coming from all over the world. I think what we don't talk about is the incredible racial segregation that exists in New Jersey. And that it has a significant impact on organizing. And so one of the things that I talk a lot about with some of my fellow co-organizers, both white and of color, is the challenge of organizing in the suburbs, because that's where we are. We're in suburban New Jersey. And I think one of the things that has been important in the past, at least, has been urging New Jersey residents who are white to start to understand the racial history of our very own state. So, for example, I mean, I was born and raised in New Jersey, and I never learned in my public school education that New Jersey was a slave state, and that out of all the northern states, New Jersey had slaves the longest. We never would talk about that. That would never come up. And so understanding our history like that, and then understanding how those patterns have had a significant impact with redlining and our system of outrageous property taxes and connected to a school system, all of these things make for a very racially segregated state. And I think that's one of the things that, at least in New Jersey, has been important to talk to, talk to white people about, especially because they, you know, they look around their white neighborhood and say, well, I don't know why. I don't know why it's so white. Or they say, I had no idea it was so white until after, you know, X number of months or years they were there. And so I think for me, looking, encouraging New Jersey white residents not to focus on racism being someplace hundreds of miles away, but to focus on it right here is a way to start to urge them to really look in the mirror. And then, of course, we expand that to a variety of other kinds of things. But one example is the racial wealth gap. It's bad enough nationally, but New Jersey has one of the worst racial wealth gaps in the entire country. The organization, the New Jersey Institute for Social Justice, has done some amazing work identifying that and really focusing that on that. One of the challenges in New Jersey is that we kind of get lost between Philadelphia and New York, and there's not, New Jersey has trouble kind of coming up with its own identity, I think. And we often in New Jersey are not paying attention to what's going on right here. But I think in a lot of ways, it is a microcosm for what's going on in the rest of the country. And rather than focusing on elsewhere, we need to start right here because the problems are serious.
Yeah, that's really insightful. It's nice to be able to, you know, be challenged and learning some stuff about the larger work you're doing, but also right there in your home state, your hometown. Let me ask you, being someone that's been teaching and at the college for so long, what has that taught you about particularly the subject of racism, white privilege, and teaching and learning over these almost two decades? Are you optimistic about the future? What's your sense, what's your feeling about, what have you learned from, you know, being at it for so long at the college, and your thoughts about what's to come, what's ahead, in reference to people receiving this, wanting to receive this, doing something, wanting to do something? Give us your thoughts on that.
Sure, absolutely. Well, I think one of the things that often doesn't really get talked about is the role of the community college. And we are an open access institution, which means that when you apply, it's not, no one's going to get rejected. It's about, you know, just sharing information about, you know, your high school or your GED or your, you know, other equivalent diploma, and that everyone really gets a chance. If they had a bad experience in the past, they can get a fresh start. Or maybe they're an honor student and they're interested in saving some money by coming to a community college. And so one of the things, though, that I've noticed is a pattern where students tend not to have a lot of confidence about their academic ability. And often they have gotten negative messages about their academic ability in the past. And so they bring that, sometimes that lack of confidence into the classroom. I know it happens in math. I teach English, so that's where I'm more aware of it. And certainly, I think that these patterns are even more profound when we're looking at students of color, especially Black and Latinx students. And certainly when we're looking at first generation students. And I think being able, and I feel like this is something that really hasn't changed that much. This pattern I've noticed pretty consistently. And so I think what can we do in the classroom to help provide students with opportunities to build confidence? And, I always am critical when my colleagues might say, well, I'm giving the students a voice. Well, they already have a voice. we're not giving them a voice. It's giving them opportunities to share that voice and to be able to strengthen it either in their writing or in their speaking. When I was a graduate student at the University of Delaware for my master's and PhD, I spent plenty of time teaching there back in the late 90s and early 2000s. And the students there academically were not very different than my composition students right now. The biggest difference was they had a lot of confidence. So if they didn't get that A, then they would be, storming in saying, I really, deserve that A. Whereas the students, that I've had, really are on a, academically are very similar, but when it comes to confidence, I think are quite different. So I think that's something that's really important to work on, and especially in the fact that community colleges teach almost half of our country's college students, but we don't really talk a lot about the role of the community college, the opportunity that that we might have. And I think there's a lot of opportunities there for the future, and giving students a chance to have another chance. And what can we do to break down the sort of structural racist barriers that they may have experienced in the past? What can we do to not replicate those barriers? I think that those are the questions that we need to be able to engage in, and really making sure students have an opportunity to raise their voice in order to work towards justice. And I see a lot of students very interested in working towards justice. And once they learn about the kinds of issues that, I'm teaching about or my colleagues are, they're very interested. They're upset they didn't learn about it before, and rather critical of the fact that, why did it take them until college to learn that race is not biological? And they want to be able to, do something about it. And I see this with both white students and with students of color.
Yeah. So how did this happen? I mean, did you grow up wanting to author dismantling the racism machine? I mean, how does one get to where you are? Can you just give us a sense? Is this something you grew up thinking about? I mean, how did you get to this point?
So thank you. So no, I did not grow up thinking about that, because I grew up as a fairly typical white middle class person in segregated New Jersey, and went to, lived in a predominantly white area, went to a predominantly white K-12 school system in the 70s and 80s. And, I didn't know whiteness was a social construct. I didn't know race was a social construct, because we never talked about it. And I certainly was interested in issues of justice and wanted to have opportunities to learn about that. But frankly, I was pretty bored with our English curriculum that really didn't engage in these kinds of issues. I did not study English because of the material that I was taught in high school. I mean, I pursued English in some ways despite that. But eventually, when I was studying literature, because I always loved to read. I mean, that I think is one of the, you know, origins of all this. I've always loved to read, especially novels. And in college, but then especially in graduate school, for me, reading literature by women of color really, I would say, was profoundly changing in my ways of thinking about race and racism. And so for me, literature, fiction, novels was my entry into this kind of work. And during graduate school in the late 90s and early 2000s, I also became very interested in the field of critical race theory that came out, at least at the time, was really focused on legal scholars doing very creative work in trying to write about structural racism. And so I was very influenced by the work of Derek Bell and Kimberly Crenshaw, and was very interested in connecting that work to the literature that I was reading. And so that was the time when I really started to learn that whiteness is a social construct, that whiteness is a category that we've, you know, that we invented, that has been maintained in various ways and readapted. And I was very interested in looking at how does literature connect to that, and how do contemporary authors talk about racial categories and you know, present them, either reinforce them or resist them. So that was the kind of work that I was initially interested in. I wasn't out organizing white people or talking to white people out, you know, in the libraries on the streets about this. It was a much more academic kind of approach. But I think once I shifted to my job at a community college, which by definition is deeply connected to the community and not so much the traditional ivory tower, I became more interested in connecting more to the community and really trying to raise awareness about the kinds of things that white people don't learn, especially, and just trying to kind of go outside of the classroom, which is why I, you know, really find giving workshops in the community important, and certainly my book was an attempt to reach that audience. And I also have a website that I maintain with resources and all of that, that is another attempt for me to try to raise awareness, again, trying to, in some ways, work to make up for the gap that we have between the scholars who study race already know so much that they don't necessarily talk about regularly because they take it for granted. And then the public, the gap between those two groups is so huge. Mm-hmm. And I feel like as a community college professor, I can connect to the community, and that's been something that can be really powerful. And I feel like that there is opportunity there for the future.
Yeah, I appreciate that. It's nice to hear about that journey. I want to ask you about advice to parents, because I'm assuming you have had this ask of you before. What do I do to my kids? What can I say to my kids? But also I'm wondering, like, white students on campus or young white students that you encounter in different places, I mean, what kind of advice you're giving to them as well? But before that, I want to ask you about COVID-19, the coronavirus. And essentially, we really had to come to a screeching halt as a nation, as individuals in all of our different professions. And I'm wondering what coronavirus has taught you about you coming to a screeching halt, but also about the machine. Like, as you look at, I mean, I'm not sure if you're planning on doing a revised version based on coronavirus, but if you were, what have you learned about what your work is all about as it relates to the pandemic?
Sure, absolutely. I mean, there are several pieces that I'm thinking about. I do want to say that I have been very much affected by the work of Kimberly Crenshaw in her most recent podcasts about called Under the Black Light, where she's every week interviewing a variety of different people about the impact of COVID-19 and its connection to racism and all these other systems. And through her podcast, Intersectionality Matters, I have found that to be extremely helpful. And so for me, one of the things that I, to build on the work that I've been doing, I added a page of resources that I keep updating, and I'm never caught up, of course, to my website, dividednolonger.com, specifically a page of resources about the coronavirus and white supremacy, whether it's anti-Asian racism or whether it's about how this virus has just revealed even more so the kinds of structures of racism that we have built into our society, whether it's the disproportionate impact on Black communities, looking at prisons, especially the prison system is already a racist and white supremacist system. And you add the virus on top of that, and it just exacerbates everything that's already there. And then the treatment of essential workers who are making minimum wage, people who are undocumented. So people who are already marginalized, through various methods, this virus has just shown that and revealed that and put their lives in danger even more than they were. And so one of the things that I've been wanting to do is making sure that white people understand that. And rather than middle and upper class white people, focusing on the, oh, I can't believe I have to stay home all day, recognizing that they should feel grateful for having a space, having enough food to eat, having a safe space to sleep at night, and really recognizing the disparity between, their situation and what is going on, with communities of color in particular. And so when it comes to the racism machine, to me, the virus is yet another way of revealing the racism machine. Just like Trump's election revealed the racism machine, each iteration of whatever is going on reveals in another way what the racism machine can do, how powerful it is. And so at least for me, having conversations virtually with white people about that and helping raise awareness about that has been important over the past couple of weeks.
Yeah. So what do you say to those parents of young white folks that have the opportunity to use this moment as a teachable moment, so to speak? But just in general, I'm wondering, I'm guessing people ask you and wonder, what should I say to my kids? What's your advice to them in reference to working with young people?
Sure, absolutely. Well, first I acknowledge to them that I'm not a parent. And so I don't have firsthand experience about that. But from the work that I've done, the research that I've done, and the many, many, many conversations with other parents I've had, my main message is kids are never too young to learn about race and racism, that white children are never too young to learn about whiteness and what that means. I think that white parents of white children in particular are very reluctant to even talk about race at all. And often they wait until those kids are, well into teenage years before that is something that's even raised at all. And so I think my first message would be the younger the better. And there are a variety of authors who've really in many creative ways done such a great job of being able to provide some accessible picture books and stories and all of that for young children as sort of a way to help them understand this. But I think, you know, children do understand power. And I think, you know, teaching some of the basics of this as about power and control is a step in the right direction. And giving young people an opportunity to be able to ask questions, I think, is really important. But those parents then have to be willing to engage in the discussion. And if those parents, if those white parents haven't really learned a lot about race and racism, they're probably not going to be that comfortable in those conversations. And so I would urge them to start doing, you know, their own learning about this so that they can sort of share this journey and also acknowledge to those kids that the reason that they didn't learn about this is because it's not really taught and that that's a problem. And so, you know, there are perhaps ways to empower white kids, especially, you know, maybe in high school, to encourage their own teachers to be able to start to teach about this. And I know that several different activists and scholars have talked about strategies for inoculating white kids against being recruited into white supremacy and white nationalism. And I mean, that's obviously a slightly more extreme part of this, but it's all connected. And I think, you know, helping very young children understand some of the basics of this is important, and then it can be built on, and that that parents shouldn't feel like they have to know everything, because they're not going to know everything. That's just not how it works.
Yeah, well, let me just give you some words and ask you for basic 15, 30 second definitions, right? Like whiteness, what's a basic definition if somebody wants to know?
Sure. So I would say that whiteness is a story made up to make white people feel special and to feel superior to everybody else. And it's based on a lie, because white people are not superior to everybody else, but they're taught that they are more fully human than anybody else.
And what about racism? How would you give a basic definition of racism?
Sure. So I would say that racism is a structure that supports the false belief or false ideology that white people are superior.
Yeah. And what about white supremacy? What are ways that you break that down simply for folks?
Sure. So I would focus on white supremacy as a belief that can take many different forms, that again focuses on white people being superior, whether it's biologically superior, intellectually superior, superior at working hard. All of those aspects of superiority are connected to white supremacy, but thinking about it as a belief that manifests itself in different ways, I think can be helpful.
And lastly, what about white privilege? How do you break that down for folks?
Sure. So I think white privilege is essentially the advantages that white people have that they think they've earned that they actually have not earned, and that it's built in. Again, it's part of the system that we were just talking about. And all of this, these beliefs might not be conscious and often are not conscious, but I think, you know, focusing on white privilege as a system of unearned advantages that white people often don't know they have and therefore are not aware of structural racism.
So as we get towards the end, I wanted to ask you a couple more things. One, about the resistance to pushback you get, which I'm assuming comes with this job, with this work, and how you take care of yourself. So what does what has been some of the resistance pushback look like for you and self-care? How do you take care of Karen?
Sure. So the resistance can honestly take many different forms. If I'm giving a public talk, for example, where it's just one single talk and I only have one opportunity to engage with people, I would say that's in some ways the most challenging because there's only so much work you can accomplish in an hour. But I've had situations where a white person last year was giving a talk at a library and a white audience member was outraged that I said that race was not biological. And he, you know, just kept wanting to come at, you know, with like all kinds of examples. And I think the problem that I had in that conversation was that I gave him too much time. I got caught up in trying to, you know, I kept saying to myself, well, if I just explain it in this way, he'll understand. And I should have just said, thank you for your comments. We're going to move on. And so, I gave him too much time and, I wished I hadn't. But I think, you know, some white people just cannot get over that very basic concept, that race is not biological. So I would say that's some of the resistance. Other types of resistance is when white people just don't want to talk about all this because they find it too, they would say it's too emotionally difficult. And, you know, then I'll say, well, if you think this is emotionally difficult, just imagine how the people that deal with racism on a daily basis are feeling. But that doesn't always go over that well, as you might imagine. I would say with my students, though, it's a different situation because we have time. We have 14 weeks and we take it one step at a time. And they're taking a class because they know that a class is an experience to grow. And even though, of course, there is certainly moments of resistance and all of that, it's just sort of a different environment, I would say.
Yeah.
And then regarding things that self-care, well, I do, and I think you'll come to this question soon, I do certainly like to watch TV and some movies as well, of course. And so I would say that's one of the things that I like to do. I love to go for walks. I often listen to podcasts while I'm walking. I garden. I'm trying to grow some vegetables. We'll see how that works.
Yeah.
I like to be outside.
Yeah. Well, we are going to get to a little TV, movies, what you're watching, what you're reading. But before that, can you just give us a sense of what's next? What next 10 years? You got some new projects on the horizon. What are some things that you got going that you're excited about? Next 10 years, what are your thoughts?
Sure. So I certainly want to be able to build on the work in the community that I'm doing and feel like we're making progress and developing a larger critical mass of people to affect change. But I also am thinking about a second book project. It's still in the very, very earliest stage. But what I'm especially thinking about is what exactly are the stories that white people tell themselves in order to maintain their denial of racism? And I think about these as false racial narratives, the stories, the dangerous stories that white people, that we try to convince ourselves of in order to ultimately, perpetuate white supremacy. So I'm not sure exactly what that will look like yet, but I'm certainly interested in making sure I'm incorporating what's going on now. I think there's also, I see some parallels in how white people react to the coronavirus in the same ways that white people reacted to Trump's election. So I'm interested in looking at some of those possible connections. But also in trying to provide a path forward, not just this is what's going on, but how can we learn from what's going on to create, you know, to change those stories and to encourage white people to have anti-racist narratives that they believe in and support.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Well, anything you want to collaborate on, White Privilege, the Privilege Institute, we are open. So always keep us in mind
if Wonderful. We
can be a resource or a place to do some collaboration. Let's ask you, what are you watching? What can you add to our list? You got some goodies for us. Anything you've read, any good novels, any good music, or any shows that you want to share?
So I'll probably focus more on TV. I know you already talked about this, but Little Fires Everywhere was absolutely amazing. So I finished that series. I absolutely loved the novel. Celeste Ng is amazing, does amazing work. Her other novel that I thought was really powerful is Everything I Never Told You. But I was so excited when I saw that Kerry Washington and Reese Witherspoon were adapting this. So that really just fascinating. I mean, Reese Witherspoon's character especially just reveals the toxicity of whiteness, especially in that last episode. But I won't give any more spoilers in case people haven't finished watching that. I also was really interested in the short HBO series, The Plot Against America, which was based on a Philip Roth novel of that name from several years ago. And it imagines an alternative history if Charles Lindbergh, who was essentially a Nazi, if he had become president instead of Franklin, instead of FDR winning a second or third term. And so that was really interesting. So Lindbergh lived in New Jersey, not that far from here. And so I certainly grew up thinking of him as a hero and not knowing too much about who he really was. And so that was, I think, really interesting. I've been a fan the whole time of How to Get Away with Murder, and that is about to wrap up. And I'm excited about that, but also sad that that'll be going. I recently watched the show Devs, D-E-V-S, on Hulu, and that was really very mind-bending, and I do like science fiction, but really interesting in terms of memory and history and how far do you push technology. And I guess the last show that I would recommend that's still going on right now is Mrs. America, which is about the work of Phyllis Schlafly, who was a very conservative anti-feminist who worked to defeat the ERA in the 70s. And I certainly knew some of that history. It's not a documentary. I mean, it is a fictional series, but really fascinating and kind of scary all at the same time. Yeah. And I'll add one final thing is the Friday before last, YouTube started to do a Friday night movie, and they started with Dirty Dancing. And so I couldn't resist, even though I've seen it a million times and I have it on DVD. But of course I was like, okay, well, I'll just sit and watch this. And it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah. Patrick Swayze, the start of the original mullet, somewhat. that Miss America just talks about what seems to be something we don't have time to talk about, the role of white women and their devastating impact on society. And so maybe next time we'll pick up with that. All right, we gotta let you go. Our next call is coming up, but Karen Gaffney, we appreciate you joining us. Thank you for all the work you're doing. Again, let us know if there's some ways we can collaborate, and you be safe. Take care of yourself out there in Jersey.
Thank you so much, Dr. Eddie Moore. I really appreciate it.
All right, peace.
Take care.